Hi everyone, welcome to Understand the Bible. Today we're looking at the question of what happens when you die. Now this is a question which everyone is fascinated by. It's one of the big mysteries of life. As I said last week, I think most people do believe that there is something that lies beyond death. So many people have said to me that they believe their relatives are up there looking down on them. But that still doesn't answer the question of what happens when we die. The Bible teaches us that there is life beyond death, but what happens when we actually die? Let's look into it now. Last week we were thinking about how we should think about death in general, and we thought about Paul's famous phrase, "To live is Christ and to die is gain." This week, we are focusing on what happens when we actually die. We're back into the Catechism, so let's look at the question for our session today. Question 37. What benefits do believers receive from Christ at death? The souls of believers are, at their death, made perfect in holiness, and do immediately pass into glory, and their bodies, being still united to Christ, do rest in their graves until the resurrection. So the first point to make is that we are talking about believers. So we're not talking in general about what happens at death. We are talking about what happens to Christians. It's important to understand, as I've tried to make clear many times through this course, that the destiny of Christians and non-Christians is different. We're not talking today about the destiny of non-Christians. We are speaking specifically about Christians. Now, the answer says three things about what happens to us at death. Firstly, that we are made perfect in holiness. Secondly, that we pass into glory immediately. And thirdly, that our bodies rest until the resurrection. What we're going to do for the remainder of this session is look at each of those three things in turn. So the first thing to say is that we will be made perfect in holiness. All the way through this course, we've seen that God is holy and yet we are not. We're sinners. We fall short of the standards that God requires of us. We do not love him with our whole hearts, and we do not love our neighbours as ourselves. If you've been a Christian for more than a short time, you'll know that sin is something that we struggle with every day. We need to continually repent of our sin and turn to Christ. While we're in this mortal life, that struggle doesn't end. But there will come a day when that struggle will end. This is what it says in the book of Hebrews. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly, to the church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. This passage says that when we come to God, we also come to the spirits of the righteous made perfect. In other words, those believers who have gone before us, who are now made perfect, that is, morally perfect. They are holy. They don't sin anymore. It says something similar in 1 John. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. John says that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. He means that we will be holy as Christ is holy. We will be sinless as Christ is sinless. As we saw earlier on in this course, our sin makes a barrier between us and God. We can't see him and draw near to him because he is holy and we are not. But there will come a day when we will see him as he is, because we will be like him. Take a moment to ponder just how amazing that is. There will come a day when our struggles will be over. There will come a day when we won't have to battle with sin anymore. There will come a day when our longings to see the Lord will be fulfilled. It's a truth which we need to remind ourselves of regularly. All of our struggles, our battles with temptation, our battles with a fallen world, all of it will one day be gone. Instead of struggling against the world, the flesh, and the devil, there will be harmony, life as it is supposed to be. We'll think more next week about what life will look like in the new creation. But there is one important thing to say first. As John says in the reading that we just read, all who have this hope in him purify themselves as he is pure. In other words, because our goal is holiness, we need to be working on that goal in this life. Think about it like this. If you wanted to move to another country, what would you need to do? You would need to prepare yourself. You know, you would need to learn the language. You would need to learn the laws and the customs of that country and so on and so forth. You know, you would need to learn how to live in that country. If you didn't, you could end up either making a social faux pas or even getting into serious trouble. For example, if you brought alcohol into a country where there was no alcohol allowed. The point is, you look at the destination and so you ensure that you make yourself ready to fit with the people in that place. It's like that with us and God. If we are to be made holy, then we can't live however we like in the here and now. We need to be making ourselves ready to live a holy life through eternity by seeking holiness now. You might say, why does it matter whether or not we aim for holiness now if in the end we're going to be made holy? That question comes from a misunderstanding. Firstly, holiness is not a bad thing. People sometimes think that holiness is a bit like eating spinach, for example. You know, it's good for you, but not very pleasant to taste. But that's not at all how the Bible presents holiness. Holiness is what we were created for. It's where we flourish and find true joy and contentment. You can't be truly happy unless you are holy. It says in Psalm 34, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." And that's what we are meant to do in this life, to taste holiness and to see that God is good. And that leads on to the second thing. If you don't taste holiness in this life, then you won't see that God is good. And if you don't see that, you could never be happy in the new creation. If our goal is holiness, but you don't want holiness in this life, then you could never be happy with God. Let me clarify that I am not talking about people who want to be holy, but constantly find themselves weighed down by sin. That's just normal for the Christian life. I'm talking about people who claim to be Christian, but can't be bothered to make the effort to strive for holiness. They can't be bothered to make the effort to read the Bible, or to pray, or to go to church, or aiming for holiness in everything that they do. I fear that those people will be seriously disappointed on the day of judgment to find that Christ says to them, "Away from me, I never knew you." Let me say once again, as seriously as I can, pursue holiness. This is not a game. If you haven't tasted and seen that the Lord is good, then pray to him and ask him every day that he would show you. Don't give up until he does. Let's move on now to think about what happens to our bodies when we die. The Catechism question says that at death, the souls of believers will immediately pass into glory. The clearest teaching on this comes from Jesus himself, when he was talking to the thief on the cross. When Jesus was crucified, he was crucified among two criminals. I think this is one of the most amazing passages in the Bible, and it's recorded in Luke's Gospel. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." One of the criminals recognized who Jesus was. He could see that whereas they were getting what they deserved, Jesus had done nothing wrong. He demonstrates a real change of heart and speaks to Jesus in humility. This is the clearest passage in the Bible that teaches all we need is a genuine change of heart towards Jesus, genuine repentance. Obviously, as we've seen all the way through this course, genuine repentance must mean a changed life. If the thief on the cross had gone on somehow to live a long life, then he would have proved how genuine he was by the way that he lived. But from what Jesus said to him, it seems that he was sincere. And Jesus says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus doesn't say next week or next year or after 1,000 years or something like that. He says, "Today." Imagine being crucified like that man and thinking, "Later on today, I will be with Jesus in paradise." One implication of this is that this contradicts the Roman Catholic teaching about purgatory. I don't want to get into what Catholics teach about purgatory, but I will simply say that I don't believe the Bible teaches it. When we die, we are with Christ. It's that straightforward. Before we move on, I just want to mention the word that Jesus uses, paradise. We tend to think of the word paradise as being somewhere perfect, like a beautiful holiday location. For example, some people might say a beautiful island in the Caribbean is paradise. This is sometimes the way that people think about heaven. You know, it will be like a perfect holiday destination. However, that's not what Jesus meant. He had something more specific in mind. The word paradise actually means garden. In the Old Testament, the same word was used to translate the Garden of Eden. That's why Jesus chose the word paradise. Now, to Jesus, it meant life as it was supposed to be, life that God had given in the Garden of Eden. The Bible never talks about us going to heaven in the way that most people use the phrase today. Instead, our hope is in the resurrection. We're going to consider this in more detail next week, so let's move on to the last topic for today. The final part of the Catechism said that our bodies, which are still united to Christ, rest in their graves until the resurrection. This leaves something of a conundrum. What happens to us in between the moment that we die and the moment that we are raised again? Some people advocate for something called soul sleep. That is, although we are still alive, we sleep until we receive our resurrection bodies. That does have some support. The Bible sometimes uses sleep as a metaphor for death. At the same time, I think that view does run into difficulties, not least what we saw a moment ago about the thief on the cross. Jesus could hardly say, "Today you will be with me in paradise," if the thief was going to be asleep for hundreds or even thousands of years. There are also other parts of Scripture which we need to take into account. So let's look at a passage from 2 Corinthians. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. Now this is not an easy passage to understand or interpret. Paul compares our mortal life here with a tent. Now it's something which is temporary, in contrast with our heavenly dwelling, which will be permanent and eternal. He goes on to say, while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. That means that in this mortal life, we can't be with the Lord in the way that we want to because of our sin and this fallen world. But when we are away from the body, then we will be home with the Lord. Paul seems to be saying that when we depart from this mortal life, we leave our bodies but go home to be with the Lord. It seems that this is where we will stay until that day that we are raised from the dead and receive our resurrection bodies. This understanding fits with other parts of Scripture, where those who have died are pictured worshipping and praising God. This is what it says in the book of Revelation. Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence." Those who have died in Christ are not sleeping, but worshipping and praising God in his presence. I don't know whether that means they are there physically or spiritually speaking. It's hard to imagine a human being without a body, isn't it? Perhaps they are given temporary bodies until the resurrection. But it seems to be the case that when we die, we go to be with the Lord, with Jesus, and are sheltered in his presence until the day of the resurrection, when we will receive new immortal bodies. And we'll be thinking more about that next week. At the end of the day, we can't really know all the details. God hasn't told us everything because we don't need to know. What we can say for sure is that believers don't need to worry when they die. God, who shelters and protects us through life, is the same God who will shelter and protect us for all eternity. Let's take a moment to pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that although we do have questions and there are things that we don't know about what happens when we die, that we can trust you. And we pray that you would help us to leave that in your hands, while at the same time focusing on what we do know, which is to grow in holiness and seeking you every day, so that we will be ready and prepared to be there when we are made perfect. And we pray that you would help us every day, help us to seek you and to grow in holiness. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks so much, everyone, for joining me for this session. This is the penultimate session of the Firm Foundations course. Can't believe we're nearly there, but only one more left to go, and that will be coming up next week. So thanks so much. If you appreciate this session, do give me a thumbs up and subscribe down there if you're not subscribed already. There's also a mailing list on the Understand the Bible website. There are more ways of supporting Understand the Bible. Check it all out, all the links down below. In the meantime, God bless, and I'll see you again soon.